Hi there, I'm David Batsoffen and I host a travel blog called Travel and Things. And every Saturday during December, I'm chatting to wildlife photographer and hide expert, Janet Kleyn. Janet, how are you doing?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
Very well, thank you. Getting to the end of the year, everybody's getting excited, 2021. Will we be allowed to return to the hide? Reminds me of that old Springbok radio show, No Place to Hide. Or in your case, no place to go to hide. What are we chatting about today?
Today we're going to chat about what makes a good hide, because there's many, many hides out there, and not just a good hide, but a good hide specifically for photography.
Okay, so take us through the process. Let's start at the very beginning. When people want to book a trip to a lodge, they find out that it does have a hide, they have an interest in photography, what questions should they be asking if they've never been in a hide before? And this is before they even arrive.
Yes. Okay, so basically, you're wanting to know, when is the best time to be in the hide? Is it morning or afternoon? I'll show you some photos later. Our hide, we actually have designed to maximize both morning and afternoon light. But they're not all designed. Not all hides are designed the same. You also want to know what the distance is to the end of the water. So you know what lenses that you're gonna bring with. And obviously, what is the level of the hide? Is it a sunken hide? Is it above ground? That sort of thing.
Okay, because the above ground ones seem to be the bird hides. For some reason, birders like to be above everybody else, or they think they are.
Otherwise, you should be bloodless.
No, but if you're looking at like red-billed quillias, they're at water level.
Absolutely.
It's just trying to pick one in that flock. That's always the issue for me. The one I think I'm focused on, I'm not.
Yeah, exactly. Well, when they're out in so many numbers, you can just take a gamble and hope one of them's in focus.
Well, this is it. I mean, when they say that after the domestic chicken, they're the most numerous bird in the world, with their numbers into the billions. Literally.
Correct,
billions,
yes.
Yeah. All right, so now you've arrived at the hide, or you've arrived at the lodge. What can you expect to find inside the hide? Is it just like an empty box with a chair, a rather uncomfortable chair, and if you're lucky, somewhere to put your camera gear?
Yeah. Look, different hides offer different things. Our hide is quite basic, but we have a comfortable, it's a bar stool with cushioning. So it just offers you freedom to move around a lot more than being restricted in a tight chair. Mm. There's a shelf to put your camera on with bean bags, and we've got these great rotating plates, so swiveling your camera around is very easy. Again, I prefer that to a gimbal head or something where your camera is actually locked in, because you may choose to, if the elephant comes really close, to change your shot and then it simply take it off the bean bag, put the next one on.
Yeah.
Or pick up your camera and put it out the hatch so that you can get the right angle. So for me, a lot of flexibility. And then obviously space to put all your spare equipment is essential. We've got shelving and lots of place to hang things. And then there's the little luxury of serving tea and coffee, but those aren't essentials, but we do it because people like it.
Well, if you're going to be sitting there for a long time, I was recently at an above ground hide and I'd said to the lodge, look, take me there. It was a 20 minute drive. Leave me straight after breakfast and come and fetch me at lunchtime. So I sat there for a good 6 hours. Yeah. And for 5.5 hours, nothing happened. Literally nothing. And as I was dozing off, it all exploded. Giraffes from the left, waterbuck from the right, impalas from all over. That last sort of half an hour before they came to fetch me, everything crossed in front of my lens.
Well, I mean, my joke with guests is that I'm the elephant whisperer and I can call them in just with the smell of coffee, because without a doubt, nothing will be happening. I'll say, okay, let's have a cup of coffee. And as I start making the coffee, bang, they arrive. And then everyone gets cold coffee 2 hours later when the elephants.
Yeah, it everything else just pales into insignificance next to what's happening in front of you. Talking about what's happening in front of you, let's talk through some of the slides that you prepared for today's chat.
Sure. I'm going to just quickly share my screen. Bear with me here.
Yeah. There we go.
Have you got it?
Yes, I have. Very okay. Nice young hyena pup by the looks of things.
It is, yes. So basically what I've done is taken a selection of photos here, all taken from our hide, just to show you how you can maximize the lighting at a hide and what sort of things help create a better hide experience.
Right.
Okay, so we start with this young hyena pup. That's lovely early morning light. And the way we've positioned our hide is facing south. So we can, because the sun always moves in the north in the southern hemisphere.
Right.
So early morning, we get beautiful side light. And then late afternoon, we get side light from the other end.
Okay.
If you're a little bit earlier and the light's still quite low, you can even play a bit with backlighting, which I did there very early one morning, and the light was coming through directly behind.
Right.
Obviously, ideally, you want something with a little bit of hair, warthogs, that sort of thing. Baboons work well, but yeah, I had this young elephant that was still sprouting some hair.
Just let's hold on this for a moment, if you would, Janet. I love baby elephants in water because they have, specifically, they're very, very young. They have no idea what their trunk is there for. And they will spend an inordinate amount of time, and if you're prepared to take hundreds of images, you may get one that's workable, of them trying to figure out what this appendage is, A, and B, how it operates.
Yes, yes. And then sometimes they get frustrated and they just go, poof, and put their mouth straight into the water. It's like, this thing doesn't work.
Right.
Very cute. This little elephant here loved the water and was playing and actually got a little bit stuck in the mud. Then you can see the mud came and gave it a gentle help out the water with her trunk. It was a really beautiful moment. and I had fortunately been playing with backlight because it was very tricky lighting conditions. So I just caught the moment. Yeah. So there you, that's our morning light. And then if you happen to come, because a lot of people I have don't want to come to the hide in the afternoon. For some reason, they've got it in their head that things only happen and the light's only beautiful in the morning. But in fact, I find our afternoon light incredible. And here's a lovely example. So probably about 5 p.m. as a young Eland male comes in. And again, just this lovely soft side lighting coming in from the end. And then as the afternoon progresses and the sun goes down, you can, I think you like my term, rinse and repeat.
Yes, I do. Look at that.
And you can again play with backlighting. And this particular image, I just love it because you've got two different species and what there was in the middle was a puddle of water. And it was so bizarre because we've got this whole big area of water that they both from that puddle, and there was a little bit of a standoff, and I think you can guess who won.
Yep, and those simians are cheeky. Both of them will bare teeth and bounce around rather than give up.
Exactly. The monkey eventually left with his tail between his legs and came and drank at the big waterfall.
Literally.
And then for those brave enough to spend a full day at the hide, It is quiet during the heat of the day and the light can be pretty harsh, but it doesn't mean there's no photon option. And sometimes I'm surprised when I stay for a full day, for whatever reason I might stay on my own or a client wants to stay for a full day. And every now and again at the heat of the day when you expect nothing, you get something. And it's very bright light, but you can work with it. There's no harsh shadows because we're facing south.
Yeah,
that's probably one of the most important things to look at when designing a hide or when going to a photography hide. Another thing that we look at is the approach, the slope to the hide. So you can see in this picture, and in most of my photos that come out of the hide, those that I've shown you and Will, the feet are not cut off. Nothing can spoil the image more than feet cut off. So you've got to watch the angle of the approach of the slope coming into the hide. You don't want too much of a downhill, but you've got to be very aware of something I do a lot of is this edge here of the water. Elephants kind of, as they play and they swim and they push it up and then it starts to raise and eventually it's high and it gets to sort of that level and it cuts off the feet of approaching animals. So at least on a monthly basis, we get a grader in and just flatten it again so that when they approach, you've got the full animal. And
I'm also glad to see that that berm or that edge of your waterhole is mud and not concrete because I have I have an issue with concrete edges in front of a hide. because it ruins the image. Yes, it's a water hole, but it's a man-made water hole, and very obviously so.
Correct.
It's like collars on cheetah. I'm still of the school that says I don't photograph, or I photograph a cheetah with collars, but then I will wait until they're in a position where I can't see the collar.
Correct.
But it's much like cutting off feet, I suppose. There are some who don't care.
Yeah, I find with collars on animals, if it's serving a purpose for conservation and it's that sort of thing, you know, if it's not where the animal's collared, just so it makes it easy for us to find.
Yeah.
I'm quite happy to, you know, we had some wild dog that we released, and the female was collared, the alpha female. And that served a very real purpose.
Right.
And in that case, I shot, and I was just aware she is wild, she's natural, but we're doing this to help protect it. It's not a case of we're collaring the animal and then going out and just driving straight there to make it easy to find.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's sort of a line I draw there. Fair. The other thing is, our particular water hole was always a natural pan.
Okay.
So it would have in the wet season filled up, and the elephants and the warthog and all of that would have used it for rolling in the mud, that sort of thing. So we've tried to keep that there, and they use it for that. I'm not sure if I've got a photo, but definitely next week I'll put one in.
Okay.
Where they roll in the mud. So it serves a purpose. I know the maintenance team sometimes get frustrated with me and some of them have said, can't we just concrete this? I'm like, no, because they use this. It's part of their life.
Janet, the other thing, looking at this particular image, which has a really, really, pardon me, a really nice reflection of the elephant, would you crop that to remove it? Or do you photograph to try and get as much of the reflection in as you possibly can?
Yeah, it all depends, obviously, on the day. You know, windy days, the reflection is not as beautiful, although sometimes the rippled water can create beautiful effects. So depending on what's coming in, how many animals there are. In this particular one, it was a single elephant. You can see right in the back, the others are following, and the water was fairly clear, so I wanted the reflection. And I literally just kept my eye on the camera as he approached until I felt I had enough reflection in the water.
Right.
Because ideally you want a full reflection, although sometimes that can also be a bit weird. That depends, yeah, it really does. If I hadn't wanted the reflection, I try and avoid cropping too much post-processing. I would have just zoomed in more.
Yeah, that does make more sense.
Yeah. But reflections, and that is another quality looking for in a hide, is good reflections.
Yeah.
I find a very mirror-like reflection sometimes can appear quite fake, and it's not.
It's almost like it's been photoshopped in.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, you get these hides where they've got shallow water specifically made for that, and I'm not a fan, but I like to portray nature and the natural environment. Different strokes for different folks.
Fair enough.
Another thing that we look for in hides is where there's a potential for good bokeh. So you want to have the backdrop quite far back. You know, in our case, we're on the edge of a riverbed, but the tree line is about 50 meters back. So it makes it very easy to narrow your depth of field and get this lovely soft background. And you don't want to leave too many bushes and things nearby, because otherwise you're going to have a busy background, and separating and isolating your subject becomes challenging. So I've just got two examples of our lovely soft backgrounds that you can get.
And there's something special about guinea fowl images. They look like they should be in Jurassic Park, the remake.
And you know, there's some, what's special for me is particularly from around June through to September, there's always guinea fowl at the hide. So we can be having a quiet day, but you can never get tired of shooting guinea fowl. And they're beautiful. I mean, they're a photographer's dream. They've got pattern, they've got colors, and sometimes they're just very amusing to watch.
Have you ever had it where one has sort of wandered into the hide by accident, or do they not come in front of the hide?
No, they don't. They stick on the other side of the water. But we have a lot of fun, and it's really difficult to catch two guinea fowl fighting, because often we, more than elephants, we'll have thousands of guinea fowls, literally thousands. Guinea fowls, and they kind of just all walk around, and all of a sudden two will break out into a fight, and trying to anticipate who's going to break out into a fight is a challenge. But the thing with guinea fowl is you can't really tell the difference in the sex. And the one thing that is their posture. And the males walk the sort of more upright, bully type of posture on their toes and are the aggressors. And I'll just try and find one that's looking aggressive. And then I'll zone in on him and I'll just stick with him. And guaranteed within a half an hour, he's going to pick a fight.
You must just look at the t-shirt when it says, I'm the man in this, I'm the man at this pan. Then you know that he's the one. I'm
not getting into a sexist talk here. But just look at guinea fowl.
Fair enough.
Then another consideration is where you put the hide, just generally where you put the hide. I mean, we've looked at putting up a second hide and I found so many perfect spots visually. You know, the backdrop is far, the approach is great, everything's perfect, but the animals don't go there. so of course our hide was already a working pan. Animals came through, it's on an elephant path. So you're not attracting them. You may put water in an area where there's no animals. Maybe after 5 years, they'll learn it and they'll come there. But why mess with that? So we are on an elephant route. And generally, we open up our hides in March. And the day I fill that hide with water, the first elephants just come marching through. It's uncanny, actually. And herds and herds, as you know, because you've seen. And then the last thing is just a little cute time lapse I've got just to show the diversity of what can come through. And that's because we've got a well-positioned hide. And I'm going to play this for you. It's a little time lapse I did. Sorry, it's a bit skewed.
I'm sorry. All I've got in my head at the moment while watching this, Janet, is
I love this.
I've got the Benny Hill theme tune in my head.
We got to put that to this video. And after the giraffe drinks, obviously it's like the wildebeest.
Giraffe is back looking very confused.
And that's it.
And the guinea fowl. Yeah, that's wonderful.
Condensed hide session.
You want to bring us back to the two of us on screen? There we go. Thank you very much. Wonderful stuff. Wonderful stuff. Thank you so much for sharing that, Janet. Once again, if people want to find your work, where do they go?
Instagram is the best place. And just look for Janet Kleyn with a Y. K-L-E-Y-N.
K-L-E-Y-N. Janet, next week, what are we looking at?
I think next week I'd like to share some special moments with you that I've had in the hide.
Great stuff. For people like myself that are not able to go to hides at the moment for a variety of different reasons. Our chats during December so far have been very special for me. So I'm really looking forward to next week's chat. You have yourself a wonderful week. Stay healthy. Stay safe. And we will chat again next Saturday.
We will do. Thank you, David.